Listen, we are so happy that all of you came here tonight. We are so blessed that you came. We want you to recognize that you came here to be perfected. And if you don't get that, then you're just not even participating. You've got a wrong assumption about why you're here. You're here to be built up and strengthened. You're here to be taught of God things that you're not going to be able to get without His apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Things that you're not going to ever going to get to be established in unless you're in a church where those things which God placed in His church are present. He placed in His church apostles and prophets. He placed in His church teachers, gifts of healing, working of miracles. He placed within His church all the manifestation of the Holy Ghost, the mantles of heaven, so that you can learn how to function in them. Amen. So that you can learn how to participate as a member in the body of Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. And so tonight, tonight this is what it's going to be all about. We're going to here help you try our very best by all that Father has given to us and with your cooperation to see you establish in some things that will ultimately result in the kingdom of God being advanced and people that are lost coming to know Him and people that have never really understood how to step in the benefits being taught by your example, the way that you live. See, Father gave everybody a measure of faith so that it can grow and mature. But if you don't do anything with that faith, it's never going to grow, it's never going to mature, it's never going to increase. And Father demands increase. I'm going to talk to you about Father tonight demanding increase. And it's not something that we do, it's something that He sees within our hearts, such a hunger and such a passion and such a thirsting to have and to do, that then He supplies the divine ability. See, all we need is faith the size of a seed. Why? Because the seed is going to result in a tree that's going to fill all the earth. It's going to result in a big, big, big thing. A big thing that's going to grow and increase. And, when I see a tree not growing properly, I recognize that it's diseased. It's not getting the right nutrients. Of course, when it's not getting the right nutrients, it's going to be diseased. It's not planted in the right place. There's all kinds of reasons. There's certain trees, if you take them right now and they may be doing great, you take something just like them, you take them up north, they're not going to do good at all. You take trees from up north and you bring them down here and you plant them here, they're not going to do it good at all. So we're going to find out exactly what your life is meant to be about, what you're supposed to be doing. The Lord's purpose is that you be planted in His house. Amen. And that you be planted in the holies of holies. Amen. And that if you're planted there, then you're going to grow and you're going to produce fruit. I started telling everybody, I said, what you need to do is everybody needs to pray and cry out to God that neither Hillary nor Bernie becomes president of the United States, because it really is going to make a difference. Some people say it doesn't matter if it's a Republican, Democrat. No, it does matter. It really does. There's measurable distinctions. And I could have everybody praying and crying out to God. But if you don't go vote, guess what? Your prayers are invalid. Your prayer is totally invalid. It's nonsense. In fact, it was hypocrisy. It was something that you were asking God to cause someone else to do that you yourself weren't willing to do. So it was, maybe it was even worse than hypocrisy. Maybe it's just doubt and unbelief. I don't know what it is. It's just bad. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. The same way if you just started praying and say, Father, I want to be used in reaching the lost. And you never give yourself to understanding how to minister by the Spirit to someone who's lost. To someone who's backslidden. Someone who's wavering. I know there's people in here today. I walked in, I heard Tori just testifying to Josh, just telling about the people that are getting healed, family members. I know that here's another miracle man God's raising up right here. Just say, hey, you find a need, go lay hands on a dead person, raise them up. Get after it. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Because what is that going to work out in? That is going to work out a growth and a maturation of your faith.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That is going to work out the dynamics of where you learn how to flow in the Holy Ghost. You learn how to move in the Spirit. God is a Spirit.
Amen.
And until you learn how to move in the Spirit, you're just stuck. And a lot of people have never learned how to move in the Spirit. They have never learned how to move in the Spirit. They have never learned how to move in the Spirit. It's like having 3 or 4 syllables in tongues when there's 10,000 syllables. Huh? It's stuck in a li li da la. 3 of them, something like that, when there's tens of thousands. Because there's a vast variety and great expanse and greater dimensions of the Spirit for you than there are galaxies in the sky, in the universe. Can you imagine that? Can you picture that? When I look out, and I love looking out in the sky, and the expanse of the sky, especially when there's no light pollution and you can really see, and no overcast, or looking at the pictures of things that telescopes that have been sent out into outer space have taken, because I'm looking at the vast expanse of God's gifting and God's glory and that which is made available in His life to me. Hallelujah. I want you to get out of whatever thing you've been living in. Amen. I want you to get up on the mountaintop of vista view of all that Father has made available for you. Get excited. Don't go live in the desert when He built your house in paradise. Amen. I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing. The quality of life that people would be willing to live in when God has given to us a quality of life that it goes way beyond anything that you and I could ever possibly imagine. Hallelujah. Mangeshe kara monzezi taro tiapane ikseya monbete se boravande. So the Spirit of the Lord says, look and see all the vast variety of things that I've given you in the realms of the Spirit, in the realms of my abundant life. You know, the Lord told me, He told me to go to the churches in the United States of America and tell them to receive the life of Christ. Tell Christians to receive the life of Christ. Because what they did was they stepped into religion. They never stepped into the life of Christ. They never stepped into the expression of God's life. They lived out their life. And I'm telling you, that's just really a bummer. You know what I'm saying? Because now you're trying to live some kind of life you have no power or ability to live. You don't even know who you look like, what you're supposed to act like. It is just really a very conflicted kind of a lifestyle. And so in the name of Jesus tonight, you're going to hear some things. But you know what? If you hear them and you don't do them, it will not profit you. If once again, if you start praying and crying out to God that, you know, that Hillary and Bernie doesn't get elected president and then you don't go vote against them, I mean, your prayers are invalidated. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
It is invalidated. If you pray that there's signs and wonders and miracles in your life and you don't go do signs and wonders and miracles, somebody said, how do I go do signs, wonders, and miracles? Well, when you see somebody sick, you lay hands on them. Yes. And then if you see some kind of deficit, some kind of lack, you're not getting the results you're supposed to have, you go back to the prayer room and you learn how to yield to the Holy Ghost and flow in the things of the Spirit so that the next time you lay hands on someone, there is a greater demonstration of it. And it is, you know what? He's given you enough faith to do this. He gave you the faith the size of a seed, and the seed contains a tree that fills the whole earth. A seed will grow into a tree that gives you everything, that supplies everything in every dimension of all that God Himself has for us, which He says is all of His fullness. Pretty radical? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay, well, I'm going to get you into the Word here, okay? I'm going to lay it on you real thick and heavy. I want to just say this because I don't know that people get it. If you say, Lord, I want to be used by You to see people that are tormented, afflicted, healed, set free, and you don't go out and minister to them by the Holy Ghost, because it's not counseling's not going to do it. And medication isn't going to do it. But the power of the Holy Ghost will result in this transformation, this change happening in people's life. If you'll pray, if you'll ask Father, He will then show you. He'll give you practical application, and then you go back to the classroom, in the prayer closet, in the relationship with Him, and He instructs us, and He shows us how to move with Him, and He shows us where we got off in fear, or where we got off in our own understanding, or where we started doing it after our own thinking. Hallelujah. And He shows us how to think like He thinks. He shows us how to move with the confidence and boldness that He moves in. He shows us how to move in the faith. And it's a development. It's a growth, and it's a maturation process. Hallelujah. Then you begin to learn. You begin to learn where there's no faith. When there's no faith, you can't do many miracles. But what you do is you preach. But you got to know what the right thing is to preach. And you're not going to know the right thing to preach unless you've learned how to let the Holy Spirit enrich you with all utterance. Now, what I'm telling you is I'm laying out for you all the things that the Bible says that people can't find the proper places to put it in their life. They just don't have the right categories of their life. Because why? Their life is about living out the things that they normally do. Jesus said, if you live your life for yourself, you will lose your life. He said, but if you lose your life for My name's sake and for My word and for My kingdom, He said, then you'll find it. And I'm telling you right now, He said that in the context of making it very clear in Mark chapter 8, verses 33 through 38, about who is serving him and who's not serving him. And you're just going to, it's so very, very important. So very important that you understand this, dear people. It's so extremely important that you understand whether or not, basically, you're serving the Lord. If I ask you, are you serving the Lord? You want to be able to say, yes, I'm serving the Lord because I'm doing the things that he said for me to do. Not just subjectively, oh, I'm serving the Lord because it's my religious, belief or ideology or something that I learned from some, traditional, belief system. What does God say? He made it very clear what it means to serve him. If somebody says, have you been born again? Do you have the life of God? You got to know what that means. Otherwise, you could say, yes, I've been born again. I've got the life of God. You're not living the life of God. You're not living the life of Jesus. You're not living the life of the Holy Ghost. So it's best to be able to understand really what the meanings and the definition of things are so that you can say, yes, I got it, or no, I don't have it. Because if you're not certain, there's no hope for you. If you think you have something that you don't have, there's no way you can ever have it. Doesn't that make sense? Because you'll never be hungry for it. You'll never want to get right. You'll never understand the basic, as it were, distinction between the way you're living your life and what God has for you. But if you can begin to get a contrast between the wonderful life that God has for you, the abundant life that God has for you, and the life that is purely human, I'm going to tell you right now, you'll run with everything you've got to lay hold on that life. Amen. It's a huge difference. God's not blessing human life. He doesn't receive praise from men. God's gone forth looking for those who will worship him in spirit and in truth. That's what he did. And that's what Jesus said. And when he talked about this wonderful place that he's given to us of his life, he said, this is what the Father is looking for. And he was talking about the Holy Ghost. And he said, if you receive this gift, there will be a wellspring springing up on the inside of you that will produce the life of God. Yeah, John 4:16 is just as important as John 3:16. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. It's just as important. If you'll recognize who I am and the gift that I have for you, then you will have a wellspring springing up on the inside of you, providing for you the life of God, an unending life, a quality of life that is God's life, not a quality of life that is human life. God created a new race of men in Christ Jesus. As much as Father brought forth a new race in Abraham, and we call them Jews now, God brought forth a new race in Christ Jesus. And this is what the Word of God teaches. This is what the Bible teaches. Father doesn't say, listen, come into a belief system and I'm going to come and try to find a way that I can fit into the life that you're living. He says, no, I'm blowing your life up. Amen. And no, your life comes to an end. It's over. Done. That's the covenant. You no longer live. So ultimately, people have a hard time wrapping their head and heart around this. They go, wait a minute. I no longer live. It's Christ that lives. Well, I don't even get that. Well, because if you'll look at it from a different perspective and say, wait a minute, I've received this life of God, and then begin to experience it. Because if you don't experience it, then it's just fictional Christianity. It's a rainbow Christianity. It's an ideology that you can never catch up with. It's a whole bunch of ideas and blessings and promises that have really no value to you because they're never really witnessed in your life. And they can be witnessed in your life until there's a transformation, until there is absolutely a change. But when the change comes, when the transformation comes into your life because you received a miracle where you were crucified with Christ, you no longer live. I mean, when you begin to think about the very tenets of faith, I no longer live. I was crucified with Christ. I was buried with him by baptism into death. I mean, when you begin to understand salvation on the same basis of which Paul demonstrated and talked about salvation, in Titus, for example, in Titus chapter 3 and verse 5, look what he said. He said that we've been saved by the white. And here's the definition of saved. You've been washed by being regenerated by a whole new genetics. Literally, you've been washed by being regenerated. Gename in the Greek language, it's to have a whole new genetics. By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost. So you're entirely different. Your life is entirely changed. Now, if you say, well, I'm Christian, I'm walking with God, and your life's not entirely changed, you've got a wrong definition. You've got a non-biblical definition of salvation. And so, therefore, what are you stuck in? Called deception. And now you're just belonging to a, you know, the Christian club, a Christian club that is literally living their own life. And Jesus said, if you live your own life, you don't have my life. If you live your own life, you're going to lose it. You're going to have to lose your life so that you can have my life, so that you can find it. If you grab a hold of my life, I'll give you my life. But now what you're going to understand is that you're going to have to do this. You're going to have to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. And that means you no longer live for yourself, but you live for what Father said to do. And what Father said to do is he told you and I to go and be busy about the kingdom of God. Amen. He told it, and he told it, and he said it in this context, because you'll remember that, you know, things are starting to go good for Jesus, right? And from Peter's perspective, and from the, come on in, and from the disciples' perspective, and from the apostles' perspective, things are starting to go good for Jesus. Been some up and downs, but now he's getting popular, and they're really excited because they're becoming famous. And now Jesus says, listen, I'm going to be rejected by the priest and by the elders and by the scribes, and I'm going to be killed. And Peter takes him aside and says, takes Jesus aside and says, hey, Jesus, come over here. I need to talk to you. Come here, man. Hey, listen, you can't be talking like this. Look, we got some momentum now, and everybody's going to get all disappointed and feel bummed out. And he's saying, and he looks at Peter and says, you don't even know what you're talking about. You think like a man instead of thinking like God. Let me just tell you what this is all about. And he says, Satan, you get behind me now. Now he turns and he looks at you and me right now. Jesus is now looking and staring at you in Mark chapter 8 and verse 34. He's staring at you. He turns now. He's there with his apostles. And he turns now because he called the people to come also. Okay? He turns and he's now looking at the people and he's looking at you and me right now. And he says, let me tell you something for sure. Unless you lose your life, you shall not find it. If you hold on to your life, you shall lose it. But if you lose your life for my namesake and for my word, he tells us that we will find his life, that we will have his life, that this is what it means to serve the Lord. He said, if you're ashamed of me in this adulterous and sinful generation, he said that I'm going to be ashamed of you. I will reject you when I come with my Father and his holy angels. Okay, now you're set up for Mark chapter 9 and verse 1. Are you ready? Yes. Are you listening to me? Yes. And so, hallelujah. Jesus says, I tell you for certainty that there are some of you standing here that will not taste of death until you see the kingdom of God come with power. Are you there? Is everybody there? So, you know, am I quoting it right? I'm quoting. Of course I am. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. Okay, listen, so he's now what's going to happen is if you look in all the Gospels in which this is recorded, in Matthew, in Mark, and Luke, you will always have this statement right before what Jesus is going to do when he takes Peter, James, and John apart with himself up into the mountain, and he's going to show them the glory of what it looks like, to interact with the kingdom of God. Are you ready? Yes. Because what happens is people do not want anything to do with the Holy Ghost. They want it to be purely men. They want to have an interaction with God that has no supernatural expression of the Holy Spirit. But such a thing is foreign to the Bible, both Old Testament and the New Testament. What makes all of God's people different, whether it's in the Old Testament or the New Testament, is they stand in the midst of a place called the heavenly. They stand in the midst of a place called the supernatural. They stand in the midst of a place called the miraculous. Hallelujah. And I'm going to prove that to you. I'm going to prove it to you with the Word of God. Because this isn't some anecdotal. These aren't little anecdotes, okay? These are absolute established truth. It's more than fact. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? So, I'm going to set this up for you. I want you to understand that there were many of those who were standing there that would not taste death till they'd seen the kingdom of God come with power. It's the first part of this is going to be what's going to be next said here in the Mount of Transfiguration, and we're going to talk about that, but I don't want to limit to that, because they're going to also see the kingdom of God come with power, because they're going to watch Jesus crucified at Calvary's cross. That doesn't look like the kingdom of God come with power, but it's going on. The big things are going on right there. What an intense church meeting, okay? Blood, cussing, people fighting. It was intense. First church meeting. Are you with me? Yeah. First New Testament church meeting, so to speak. I mean, really, the first New Testament church meeting was Acts chapter 2, verse 4, when everybody was baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire and began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Ghost gave them utterance. Yes. That's what it means to live in the church. That's what it means to live in the realms of the kingdom of God. And I'm going to prove that to you here in just a few minutes. Where demons are going out of people, the sick and the diseased are being healed. The power of God is being manifested and revealed with joy, with righteousness, and with peace in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. With signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. And for those of you who know the Bible, you know I'm just quoting verses of Scripture. You know, I'm not just throwing out some verses or some sentences that are pulled together in some kind of a fashion to create a paragraph of something that men, you know, that come up, that I came up with or some man came up with. I'm just quoting the Word of God to you. And I'm quoting the Word of God to you because the Word of God is powerful, it's faith, and it's authority that will begin to work in you and that will believe. Those of you who will start agreeing with God and doing it. Somebody said, well, I prayed one time and I didn't get my answer. Well, my goodness gracious. I mean, what kind of expectation is that? Father, we're like newborn babes desiring the sincere milk of the Word, and we're supposed to grow thereby. We're the people who are supposed to go everywhere preaching the gospel, and as we do, we're going to develop in the things of the Spirit. You know, God, when Jesus sent them out to preach the gospel of the kingdom, you know, and I'll give you a bunch of verses of Scripture on this, but for example, and I'll take you to them in a little bit, Luke 9:2. I mean, forgive me, yeah. Yes, Luke 9:2, Matthew 10:9, Luke 10:9, Matthew 10:1, okay? We're going to get there, but I'm just talking about the kingdom of God and what they're supposed to be doing. What are they supposed to be doing? They're supposed to go raise the dead.
Amen.
Supposed to go raise the dead. Yes. When's the last time you raised the dead? When's the last time you attempted to raise the dead? What? Are you crazy, man? Are you completely out of your mind? You can't raise the dead. No, Jesus told you to raise the dead.
Amen.
Yes, he did. He told you to go open up the eyes of the blind.
Yes.
He said, go cause the deaf to hear.
Amen.
Crippled to walk.
Yes.
Cleanse the disease. Cast out devils. Everybody who believes, you have authority over all unclean spirits to cast them out. He said, I give you power and authority against all unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all sickness and diseases.
Amen.
Now, the disciples went out in that authority. They came up against something that they had never experienced before. And here's a little kid thrashing around, foaming at the mouth. And, you know, and it was pretty hectic. I mean, when you start to pray for somebody, they run into the wall and they go bash themselves up against a tree. And then they try to jump in the water and drown themselves. And if there's any fire, they try to get themselves into the fire. That's pretty hectic. You know what I'm saying? You're going to go, wow, you know. And I'm supposed to be taking this on. And then to make matters a whole lot worse, now you got some people who are supposedly experts who are the religious leaders. If you can stay in the meeting, it would be great. You know, that are supposed to be religious leaders. So you got people coming and going. It looks like a traffic jam over there. But you got people who are supposed to be the religious leaders who know, going, okay, listen, I'm going to tell you, this is a very unique situation. I came up against one of these one time, and it really has to do with the fact that it's a full moon. That's basically the advice that they were giving. No. And Jesus looks and sees them talking to these guys that are idiots. When it comes to the things of the Spirit, they're spiritual leaders, they're the elders and leaders, but they're idiots when it comes to the things of the Spirit. He goes, why on earth are you talking to them? What are you going to try to get from these guys? And he's like, goes over to the other guys and he said, the leaders, he said, shut up, leave my disciples alone. And he goes, what's going on here? And then the father comes running to him and says, man, your disciples are all messed up. I brought my child to him and he's gotten worse since he's been here with them. Here's the condition, and they had not been able to cast out the devil. Jesus looks around and goes, you guys, you know, basically, I'm just laying it out for you. It's a little bit of a free translation, but it's accurate. He goes, you guys, bring me the child. And he lays it out. And he basically tells them, you know, the disciples later on says, well, why couldn't we cast out this devil? Because Jesus told the devil to go, and it listened and it obeyed, you know, and it went, because he's living over in a realm called the Spirit. He's living over in the realm called the realms of heaven. See, God is a spirit, and until you learn how to worship him in spirit and truth, you're totally disconnected. I don't care how much you say you love the Lord. There's a lot of people who are sincere, but in the end of the analysis, they want God on the basis of their terms. They don't want to change. God demands absolute change. Somebody said, God is going to accept me the way I am. No, he's not. He's going to call you the way you are and demand you to change.
Amen.
And then he'll accept you. God accepts no man's person. God accepts no man's person. Huh? Somebody said, well, I haven't heard these things. Well, I'm an expert in the Word. You need to become an expert in the Word too. And then you'll know these things. Because this is what God says. I mean, Father has given us a transformation of life. He's not called, he didn't die on the cross, raised up from the dead on the third day, so that you and I could have some religious belief and continue to live our life as demon-possessed as we've always been, under the affliction and torment of demon spirits, and live just as worldly as we've always lived. There's just no way. He died at Calvary's cross, was buried, rose up for the third day, ascended up in heaven, poured out the Holy Ghost upon us so that we could live a heavenly life, so that we could live his life, so that he could be in us and we could be in him, so that we would be the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost would live in us and walk in us, that he would dwell in us, that out of our belly would flow rivers of living water, which is the unlimited expression of his own person and presence. There's absolutely nothing in there that I should spend of my own opinion. I just quote verses of scripture to you. I just weed verses of scripture together. Every one of those you can confirm. I mean, this is on tape. You know, if you're watching on the web right now, you're not sure about what I'm saying, take it to the person that you know is the theologian, the expert in the Word of God. Lay it out there and let him tell you by analysis, yes, this is the Word of God. However, here's what they're going to say. There's going to always be a condition that they're going to put on you. However, it's not our experience. Well, I tell you, sir, you need to get your experience conformed to the Word of God, because I'm going to tell you right now, all your experience is fruit that you're not what God says you're supposed to be. That's your soul's in jeopardy. Hello. Amen. Okay? Now, what's going to happen tonight is you're going to come in a crossroads, and you're going to have to deal with something. You're going to have to deal with whether or not your life is right or wrong. And then you can choose for yourself whether or not you want to get right with God, or whether you want to continue on in your wrong and try to pretend that you're right. And I'm telling you right now, when the light that is in you is darkness, when all of a sudden what you believe to be truth is deception, how great is that darkness? There's no hope for you. There's hope for the Hindu, there's hope for the Buddhist, there's hope for the heathen, there's hope for those that are right now cutting their flesh out in the jungles of Iri and Jaya, hoping that their children won't be taken by a demon spirit in the night tonight. There's hope for them, because as soon as we come to them with the gospel, they come running for some deliverance, from safety, for some help. Hallelujah. Because, I mean, they deal with demon power in a very radical way, in a very confronting way, different from what we do in our society in the Western world. You confront demon spirits all the time. You just have justified them as normal experience. You found room to socialize with them, to accommodate them. And when you're no threat to the devil, he's basically going to leave you alone and stay cloaked. You become a threat to the devil, suddenly he's not going to be so cloaked anymore. I'm a threat to the devil. See, the Lord said anybody that believes, anyone. Anyone. He didn't say first century church, just a couple of disciples, a few special extraordinary apostles. Anyone that believes, these works that I do shall he do, and greater works. This is what he said. This is the kingdom of God. And the whole of what Jesus preached, the whole message of what Jesus preached, was the message of the kingdom of God. What he sent his disciples to do was to go preach the gospel of the kingdom of God. What Paul did was preach the gospel of the kingdom of God. And so it's so important for you and I to begin to look at the spiritual dimension of the kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God is really about encountering heaven. It's about encountering the supernatural. So he said, many of you are not going to taste death. Those of you here that are not going to taste death until you see the kingdom of God come with power. And he takes Peter, James, and John up into a mountain 6 days later. You reading it? And he began to pray, and suddenly he was transfigured before them. And what did they see? All of a sudden, they saw the glory of God overshadow him. They saw Father God speak to him, saying, "This is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased, hear ye him." They saw who? Elijah and also Moses. All of a sudden, the separation between the unseen world and the seen world was completely dissolved, and they could see both realms. That's nothing strange or new to the Scripture, because we go and we look back with Jacob. Jacob's first revelation was that he was in the house of God and knew it not. There he was. He had a vision, a dream. He saw angels ascending and descending. He saw a father who stood there before him and said, "I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, of Jacob." He says, "Walk before me. I'm going to bless you." He gives to him a covenant, and he wakes up out of this vision, out of this dream, and he says, "I was in the house of God and didn't know it." First revelation is that this is the house of God, and it's not just in Bethel on a certain mountain or hill in Israel. And then we look at it with Elijah. Elijah and his servant is up against a situation where they're having to face a whole army. And his servant's going, "I mean, goodness, what are you talking about, prophet? You're a crazy man. How is it that you and I are going to be able to deal with this mighty Syrian army? How are you and I going to fare against such a great host?" Because Elijah knew their secrets. He knew what they were saying in the private council. And so they're going to come get him. They're going to come kill him. He said, "Oh, we're good, man. We're good." And the servant's going, "What do you mean we're good? What do you mean? There's two of us. Look, there's tens of thousands of them. So he says, Lord, open up his eyes so he can see things the way they really are, so he can see the reality of the kingdom, so he can receive the reality of this realm of the Spirit. His eyes were open. He saw the angel of the Lord and the horsemen thereof. And now the table is turned, and he sees those guys don't even have a chance. See what happens when you're able to look over into the realm of the Spirit? Now faith goes to an all-time high, and now two are better than tens of thousands. Huh? Why? Because you see in the realm of the Spirit who's on your side.
Amen.
Hallelujah. There's a transition there's a transition that has got to be made in our lives. But God has told us in Colossians 1:13 that we were delivered from darkness. I was delivered from everything that Satan is doing.
Yes.
According to what God said, and well over 100 verses of Scripture, I've been delivered from what Satan is doing.
Amen.
Hello.
If you've not been delivered from what Satan is doing, you got yourself a wrong program going on. You went into the wrong religion. I'm not talking about a religion. I'm talking about a relationship. I'm talking about coming to a place where you're on speaking terms with God, where you talk to Him and He talks with you, where you learn how to hear Him and you talk to Him, ask Him, and He answers. This is what God gave to us. He gave us the privilege of coming into the holies of holies. He said we have been delivered from darkness and translated into the kingdom of the dear Son right now, present tense, right now, at this moment of time. Then he goes on, of course, that's what Paul had told the church at Colossae. He goes on then to tell the church, Peter goes on then to tell the church at large something even so amazing. He tells us that if we will give ourselves to the realms of cooperating with the Holy Ghost, he tells us if we'll give ourselves to the nature and character of God, this is 2 Peter chapter 1, if we'll give all diligence to making our calling and election sure, if we'll give ourselves to virtue, if we'll give ourselves to His purity, if we'll give ourselves to His godliness, if we'll give ourselves to His love, if we'll give ourselves to His brotherly kindness, if we'll give ourselves to the things that belong to the nature of God, then what Father will do is He will open up an entrance to us. He will cause us to understand how to enter into a realm of cooperation with the power and the glory of God. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I'm going to tell you right now, you cannot afford to sit and hear the Word of God as it's going forth right now and act like it's something that is just a common, ordinary utterance of men. Because you're in a situation right now that's pretty intense. I don't know how you got here, but you're in a place right now where the Spirit of God is declaring His Word, and you're going to be accountable for it, and you're going to stand before Him in the very near future. Your life will be given account. You will give an account for your life in the very near future. And you don't want to give an account in a bad way. You want to give an account in a good way because you heard the Word of God. You trembled over His Word. You know, Father said, this is the person that I will dwell with. He said, those who are broken and contrite who tremble at My Word. You cannot walk all over the holy and sacred things of God and expect in the end to have a good position with the Lord. And so you just got to understand that there's nothing that demands greater respect and greater cooperation. I mean, when we think about the opportunity to be on speaking terms with God, when we think we have this opportunity to be taught by the Holy Ghost, who are the Holy Spirit Himself will come to be our teacher and our mentor, and that somehow we're going to deprioritize that. Somehow we're going to make our work. Somehow we're going to make our own vocation, our own interest, our own bank accounts, our own things more important than this heavenly realm. There's no hope for you to be right with God. And from the scriptural point of view and what Jesus said and what the Apostle Paul said, he tells us very clearly there is no hope that you'll be accepted by God. Now, secular humanism, which is a spirit that dominates people's minds, will say, phooey. It's not true. But that's secular humanism. And secular humanism does not have one thought in the Bible. Not one. And if you get the Word of God in you and you get your head washed with the Word of God and your thinking washed with the Word of God, secular humanism won't have a chance of talking to you. But if you don't know the Word of God, then what you have no ability to resist. You're like a person without an immune system. Every sickness and every disease that comes along, you get it. Every lie and everything that Satan is speaking out, because he's the deceiver. He's an antichrist spirit that goes about seeking whom he may devour. And the only way that you and I are going to be able to have a defense against him is that we live our life in the Holy Ghost. In the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Ghost has come to lead us and to guide us into all truth, not some truth, but into all truth. And he's a shield about us. He's a He's the fire and the glory of God all around us, surrounding us. I mean, you know, Job had a hedge. We're baptized in the glory of God, the person of God. God the Father has come to live on the inside of me. That's the revelation of some people, but this is all over the scripture. God the Father has come, Christ Jesus has come to live on the inside of me. Christ Jesus come to live on the inside of me. Holy Ghost is living on the inside of me. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, the people who are that you cannot reach at all are the people who have been, and now I used to say this, I used to ask Father this all the time. Say, Father, it's just not right that there's all of these leaders that are telling these false things from the pulpit and snaring people so that they don't move on with you. They get stuck, and they maybe get stuck in you know, various different dimensions of religion. And I'm telling you right now, there's so many different dimensions of religion. There's that dimension of religion where all you do is show up to church once a month and you're good. You're good to go. Okay? There's a dimension of religion. If you show up to church on Sunday and you give in the offering, you're good to go. Do whatever you want. There's a dimension of religion that, you know what, you need to show up to church not on Sunday morning only, but every time there's a church service, and you need to be good and try to do right, okay? And that's as far as it goes. And we could talk about all these various different slices of the Bible where people just take one or two verses of Scripture, okay, and then put that in a whole library of opinion. Are you with me? Two verses. Can you remember what you got? Can you imagine what you got? I could actually start naming denominations for you and beliefs where you got two verses of Scripture applied and actually in context to a whole library of men's opinion. Maybe you now come to a church where you've now got a whole chapter of the Bible in the library of men's opinion. Woo! You think you're really moving forward. No, you're not. You're just as lost as you were when you had two verses of Scripture. Because people think that somehow that there can be a mixture and it be acceptable to God. You're not right with God. People say, oh, I am, and everybody else isn't. Yeah, that's right. The self-justification of men has no limits. The self-deception, self-righteousness has no limits. The self-justify has no limits, has no limits, has no limits. The only way that I can be safe, I'm not just talking to you, I'm telling you how I live. I'm telling you how I'm taught of God. I'm here to perfect you and help you so that you don't fall away. The only way that I'm kept by the power of God is because I live my life in the Word of God. I bathe myself in the Word of God. And His Word of God, the Word of God becomes to me a defense against all the false words. His truth becomes a defense against all the lies. And I don't just bathe myself in reading it. I do what I read, because otherwise I've heard it and it did not mix, wasn't mixed with faith or action. Thus it did not profit, as we read about in Hebrews 3 and 4. And there's so many people who fit that category. And all you just, listen, I'm telling you right now, it's time to start sorting people out. Amen. And I'm going to begin with the church. Amen. And people come rebellious and they become defiant because I, as a servant of the Lord, start sorting you out. Start shining a floodlight of heaven upon your soul. And you act like you're not loved. My goodness, you couldn't have a greater expression of love. Somebody's going to lay down their life. You know what they've always done to those who sorted them out? They killed them. They stoned them. They've rejected them. They've spoken against them. They've trampled them. True. True. Listen, I'm going to tell you, listen to me. I love you parents, but I'm going to tell you, if you can't settle your children down, you have to take them up into the upper room. Amen. And I pray you have Pentecost. And I'm going to tell you, because you have to be sensitive to people around you. Say, I want to hear. Good. Best praise God. I'm glad you're hungry. But people around you want to hear too. And you're going to have to lay down your life for people around you. Okay? And so, yeah, I mean, it's good to walk around with the kids. I got a whole back area back there. You can walk around the kids. But you know what? When we're having meetings with Brother Yun, other people, especially when the guests are here, you don't want your child just sitting there making all kinds of a fuss. Because if they do, it's just distracting somebody. And it just really, the enemy of our soul will actually use our insensitivity to run interference against somebody else's life. And I'm telling you, people, we're going to have to be willing to start grabbing a hold of a compassion that gives us sensitivity and insight to the needs that are around us on the very basics level. We're here to sort you out. And if you don't want to be sorted out, you came to the wrong place. because we are people of change. We're the people that behold the image. We're people that look at the opportunities, the vast opportunities, that look at the vision set before us, and we're running hard after it. We're not people that's sitting in, you know, a little, you know, 4x4 cell looking at some pictures and living our life out just on some, you know, wrong premise and some wrong idea and some limited framework of human ability. Father's given us a divine power. And there's going to have to be somebody besides just one or two of us that believe this. Because, listen, one or two of us, we can actually be, you know, we can be written off. We can be, you know, we can be called professional Kingdom of God people. You know, we can be written off. They're special. They're unique. But all of a sudden, if the whole church starts living the life that Christ Jesus described, and you're not going to until you lose your life. And you know what? You're not going to until you allow the Holy Ghost to teach you how to move in spirit. Because they that worship God must worship Him in spirit. God is a spirit, and they that are going to interact with Him must interact with Him in spirit. Thus, you need to understand the very principles of how to move in spirit, how to move in the spirit. And people don't want to do that. They want to be religious. They've been taught wrong. They've got wrong models. The hardest people to teach are people that were raised in church, raised in wrong church models. I don't want that to ever be said of people here. That's why I'm making sure that I'm not having any false models of people out there that are not baptized in the Holy Ghost. I mean, I'm telling you right now, I'd rather have a person who's been saved 6 months, who are so excited and passionate about God, and they know two verses of Scripture, teach the children, than somebody who knows the whole Bible and can quote it backwards. You know what I'm saying? And doesn't have the display of the power of God, because all you're going to do is you're going to raise religious people. You're going to raise people who have learned how to yield themselves to rebellion and strife and headiness, who always got some critical thing, some analysis going on, some division going on, some strife going on. And that's the problem with the church. Satan is a master of his craft, and he knows that all he's got to do is create division. All he's got to do is create strife, and that's all that it's going to take. A little bit of envy, and he'll shut you down. And God said, I hate that thing. And everybody's a part of it. You're going to hell. And this is a bit of a free translation, but I'm going to tell you right now, it's accurate. Are you listening to me? And I'm not going to hell. And everything I possibly can do, I'm going to try to deliver everybody from hell that I can. And just because you're so sweet and wonderful, you can't disobey God and be right with God. Just because you're so blessed and adorable doesn't mean you're going to get away with wrong behavior and be right with God. Somebody's going to have to get in your face and tell you, I demand you to change right now. And somebody said, well, I'm 60 years old, and you're younger than I am. You can't correct me. Oh, yes, I can. Because it's not me. It's the Word of God, and I'm the Spirit of God. Now, if I'm saying things out of my own ideas and my own preferences and my own partialities, then I'm in trouble. But if I'm declaring the Word of God by the Spirit of God and you resist it, you are big time in trouble. Huh? Hello. Oh, we're just as right as God with God as you are, Pastor. Get your censor. Huh? The Lord says, get back out of the way. I'm destroying them. Get them out. Get out of my way right now. Most, get out. Stand back. I'm gonna let it loose. And somebody said, well, he's changed. No, he hadn't. He hates that thing. He hates rebellion. He hates defiance. He hates people being arrogant. He hates arrogance. It's an abomination to him. It's the worst possible thing you can imagine. Think of what's an abomination to you that you don't want on your plate. How are you with me? How are you listening to me? Because he's always talking about what he would have on his plate. What's a sweet-smelling savor? Okay, that's an offering acceptable unto the Lord. What would he want on his plate? What, you know, what kind of lamb? What kind of cut? Are you with me? Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. What is an abomination if it's on your plate? Now think about it. Think about it. He says, stand back out of the way. And Moses interceded, got down on his face and interceded. Said, okay, well, then I'm just tell Korah and tell, you know, Dathan, Abiram, tell them get, you know, and there was others. Tell them get their censers, huh? You know what they did with those censers? After they got swallowed up, went right down into hell. They swallowed up, went into hell alive. God hadn't changed. Huh? He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And I'm excited about it. People say, well, that's terrible. I just can't imagine relating to a God like that. Oh, I'm excited about him. I say just and righteous are you, oh God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're doing it right. Your judgments are true. Well, they took Korah and the rest. They took all of their Dathans. They took their censers, and they beat them into flat plates and put them on the altar so everybody could remember. When you go to the altar, remember, you better be careful you're coming up here. You better be careful who's censored. There's only one person. You know, God, I've anointed the person. I've anointed the person to stand before me and to minister everybody else's strange fire. Hello. People go with strange fire quicker than they go with holy fire. It is amazing to me. And I said to the Lord, back to what I was saying, I said to the Lord, why is it that you allow these people to go on tripping folks up and alienate them, alienating them with false doctrines? And the Lord began to help me understand it wasn't those ministers' fault. Though they have a responsibility, indeed, but it wasn't their fault. Because every man, God has made a way for every person to hear directly from him, because all you got to do is be hungry for truth, and the Word of God is right there. All you got to do is be hungry for truth, and the Holy Ghost is right there. All you got to do is be hungry for truth, want to be right with God, come and be sincere and honest, and heaven will fill your life. Fill your life. And so really what it is the testimony that people aren't hungry. All they're doing is they're finding religious behavior, religious manner. And just because they say Jesus don't mean nothing. Just because they say they're saved doesn't mean nothing. We got to have people who know how to move in discerning of spirit and know how to work, move in the word of knowledge, that can take the sword out and slice them in two. Somebody said, oh, your words, they like a knife. Well, praise God. Did you mean to be blessing me? Did you mean to be... Did you mean to be giving me such a statement of a blessing and reward by telling me that? That's the way it's supposed to be. My word is supposed to, that goes out of my mouth, says the Lord, and his word's now going out of my mouth, is sharp. Yes. It's a sword. Amen. You got a sword in your mouth. Well, thank you. You might have been trying to insult me, but I took it as a blessing. You got a sword. I got a sword in my mouth. Amen. And it is the word of God, and it slices. Amen. It slices. Amen. You just slice me. You just slice my soul right loose from my spirit. You just slice my joint right loose from my bone. You just slice me. You just discern the thought and the intent of my heart. And I haven't got no cover for it. So I'm going to do one of two things. I'm going to hate you, or I'm going to repent. And you got more of hating going on when the word of God goes forth than you have repenting. And we got to, people, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have to get yourself enough reality in God, enough consequence about what God demands of you to call you to recognize what is going on around here. Because if you allow God to do that, it will drive you to your knees. You won't be trying to find a place, a time to prayer. You'll be trying to find a time to get out of prayer so you can go take care of some things. Yeah. It will create a burden within you. It will create a capacity of reality within you. And God's already opened up your eyes. It happened about a week ago. Amen. Hallelujah. The ears can hear and your heart can understand. Amen. Ain't nobody without excuse in this place. You're not living under the curse. Hallelujah. You're living under the blessing. Praise God. No mind-blinding spirits are able to hold you back anymore. You have to choose to not obey God. You have to choose to not see. Huh? No one is so blind as those who refuse to see. No one is so deaf as those who refuse to hear. People, you got to understand there has to be application to these things. You have to understand it's not good enough to just quote 2 Peter chapter 1. It's not good enough. I can quote 1 Peter, the first epistle of Peter, second epistle of Peter. I can quote huge amounts of chapters and books of the Bible, but it ain't good enough just because I can quote them. I am more responsible than anybody else because I can quote them. They end me. So I am responsible to do them, to apply myself. And my goodness, I'm so excited about it. Hallelujah. Because I know the result. I mean, there needs to be forbearance. There needs to be, patience and long-suffering as we go ahead and allow God to develop us. We can't weary in well-doing because Father is putting us, he's developing us into a place. Hallelujah. God takes you and brings you alone unto himself so you don't get distracted with the masses and the busyness. To develop you to a place to put you on the forefront of things that's actually going to burn you out and wear you out in no time because it's going to be so much. Huh? It's going to be so much. Jesus couldn't find any place. He tried to go get a little bit of rest. He couldn't. They knew where he was going. They were there before he got there. No rest time. Huh? No resting. No resting. No resting. And people acting like, well, something isn't developing in their life and somehow, they're not good enough or somehow God is... failed to see them. There's nothing God ever promised anybody that he hadn't promised you. There's nothing that God's ever done in anybody else's life that he won't do in yours. Yeah. He's just going to develop you the way he's personally designed for you to be developed, and you're going to have to get happy about it. Amen. Yeah. You had to get full of confidence and faith and know who he is so you can trust him and love him. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. That is good. Those are good Holy Ghost amens. That was powerful. Praise God. Hallelujah. You need to be doing that even then when you think you're being scolded. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sometimes I used to tell my kids, no, you're not going to do that. No, I'm not letting you do that. And they would go and they respond, yes, sir. And their response was just so good. I'd say, well, I changed my mind. You go ahead and do that. Right? Are you with me? Because it's just a right heart. It's just such a right response. It's such a submission and behavior. I watch Father do the same thing. I watch Father examine us and test us and try us. I see him doing that. If I being, in contrast, evil, know how to give good gifts to my children, how much more shall our Heavenly Father give us the Holy Ghost? And the Holy Ghost and the dimension of what the Holy Ghost brings is the definition of what the kingdom of God is.
Yes.
And what you and I are defined or told to do by God is to go everywhere and preach the gospel
Amen.
Of the kingdom.
Amen.
So I'm going to get the Bible out. I just tell you right now, when people walk in, I can feel it. I know what's going on. I know what's going on in their life. They walk in, I'll change the message. Because the Holy Ghost changes the message to drill right into their life to give them an opportunity. Huh? And I pray that you, every person in this place, you become sensitive. You become burdened. Watch people walk in this place so full of the devil and believe that they're right with God. So full of demon spirits. Even a mocking spirit. See, everything is, when you get into the light, everything's revealed. There are things revealed in the church that can't be revealed anywhere else. There are things, I'm going to tell you, by practical application, I've had many things, God showed me, I've had many things revealed in the church that couldn't be revealed in my living room. In other words, I had people in my living room, and none of what was going on was revealed. But as soon as they got into the church, suddenly everything is there. Because the church is a dynamic where the discerning of spirits, it just works. When the word goes forth, it is a light. And there's a dimension, and even I'm preaching in my living room, but it doesn't reveal all the things that will happen in the context of the church. And I pray, dear people, that you'll begin to participate and understand how to participate with the Holy Ghost so that you can become really sensitive to know how to move with God to see people delivered and set free.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, I watch people come in here tonight, demon-possessed, full of the devil, and now they've got a traffic jam going right in front of them, back and forth, crying baby behind them. Just all kinds of stuff going on. Insensitivity. Distraction, right, left, and center. And you can't help it because that's the way you live. I'm here to help you live differently.
Yes.
I'm here to help you to get over into a realm where you can move into discerning of spirit so you can see, so you can be aware of what's going on, so you can understand the consequence, the truth and consequence that is going down about you. When you begin to give yourself to reaching the lost, when you get up off your knees and quit praying for God to open up doors for you and to make you a laborer in the kingdom, when you quit praying, oh God, give me souls, and you start going and you begin to deal with people on the basis of what you're supposed to do, because every person you come up against and rub shoulders with, Father's going to hold you responsible for them. And if you come by your own ability, you're going to fail every time. All they're going to do is go, well, another religious person. Huh? Yeah, God wants to give you a sensitivity to flow in the Holy Ghost, to touch their heart, to show them the love of God, the anointing of God, to break off the yokes. Hallelujah.
Yes.
To not just be friendly. Listen, be careful with your words. Don't just throw high quality words around. Huh? Be careful. Be careful. Understand how that the word of God can come out of your mouth by the Holy Ghost and can result in Father producing the fruit that he wants to produce, the change of life that he wants to produce, if nothing else, the seed that he wants to sow.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And sometimes people just know you need to know that they're going to go to hell the way they're living.
Yeah.
And they may hate you for it, but don't be ashamed of his word.
Yeah.
The way you're living, you're going to bust hell right open.
Amen.
They may say, I disagree with that, but I'm going to tell you right now, when it went forth by the Holy Ghost, it's going to be a nightmare every night. Every night they're going to have a nightmare that's going to be rolling in their head. And they're not going to be able to get it out. It's like a song you cannot dislodge. Huh? Are you listening to me? You ever heard that little jingle, Cars for Kids? How can you forget it? As soon as I detect that that's coming on the radio, I shut the radio off all real quickly, because it lodges that little thing. 1-800. I'm not going to go in. I'm trying to make a point about when you give the word of God and it goes forth. Halamasete. You speak the truth in love. I'm going to tell you right now. Posefrene. I mean, when you love people, when you love people, when the love of God is on the inside of you, you cannot possibly live with yourself. Watch them go to hell. You can't possibly live with yourself. You can't. We tell people because we love them, because we're so concerned. Why do we love them? Why do you love me? Why are you concerned about me? Because I'm filled with the compassion and love of God, Father, for you. He loved you so much. He died for you at Calvary. And I got the same love burning on the inside of me for you. God, Father's running you down. He won't let you go. He's on you. You need to stop and let him love you back. Love him back. You need to stop and let him take that love to another level in your life. So back to what I was saying here in Mark chapter 9. So what happens is they begin to get a taste of what the kingdom of God is like. What is it like to live in the kingdom of God? The spiritual world is open before them. Then it's not going to stop there, because they're going to look at Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus. Huh? That's pretty amazing. Yeah. Hey? Yeah. He comes walking in the room with the door shut. This is church. He comes walking in the room with the door shut. Hand to me. Feel. I got. You can handle me. I'm not just a spirit. Come over here. Put your hands in my... No, Prince. Take your hand in my side. When the Lord talks to us about the kingdom of God, we see in every time he mentions it, it's a display of the power of God, of that realm of the supernatural. So I want you to look here with me in a couple of verses of scripture quickly. In Luke chapter 9, to begin with, I want you to hear the gospel. This is a gospel message. And you know what? If you don't have this burning in your heart, you need to get yourself right with God. Amen. Because this is what the fire of God will do to you. Amen. It causes to burn in your heart. Amen. So we look here in Luke chapter 9 and verse... let's look at verse 2. Luke chapter 9 and verse 2. So Jesus gets there, and I'll just go ahead and get verse 1. Then he called the 12 disciples together, and he gave them power and authority. Say power and authority.
Power and authority.
Okay, so in other words, when you invested with authority, somebody's got to listen to you. Amen. And the specific ones that have got to listen to you is angels who are heirs and minister for you, huh? And devils who have to listen to everything you got to say. They got to obey you. Amen. Huh? It gives you authority in the realms of the spirit. When you have authority in the realms of the spiritual, you've got authority everywhere. Whatever you bind on earth should be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth should be loose. I give you power and authority. And look what he says to give us power and authority. I want you to understand, because the application here extends to everybody unto us right now, because I'll show you the bridge scriptures that get you there. Okay, but I want you to focus on this, because I'm really just wanting to help you understand that the interaction with the kingdom of God, to be involved in the kingdom of God, is to be involved in a supernatural, spiritual realm that the Holy Ghost fills every part of it and is revealed and seen in our lives and through our lives. So he says to us, and he says, I give you power and authority over all devils. Hey, all devils. Anything any one of them is ever doing at any time. And just to be very clear, and all diseases too. Just to be very clear, that's the kingdom of God. And what happens is people look at this and they read it, and then they have some bad experience or it isn't working for them. And instead of them going back to the teacher to be instructed how to do it right, they become all discouraged and overwhelmed and continue on in their unbelief. And that's nuts. Because Father has told us to seek first the kingdom of God. When we're seeking the kingdom of God, you know, when we're engaged in the life of Christ Jesus and what he's called us to do, when he's telling us that we're supposed to lose our life that we might find the life, and if we're going to hang on to our life, we're going to lose it. And when we're talking about hanging on to our life, people, listen, I want you to hear this. I want you to hear me. Amen. Those of you that are here and on the web, there are everybody saying that they're serving the Lord, but they're not serving the Lord the way Christ Jesus defined it. He said, you know, what it means to serve the Lord is that you lose your life, just like I've lost my life, and then you'll find it. But if you continue to hold on your life, then you're going to lose it. And he describes how we're to serve in the kingdom of God, to live out a life of ministry as he did. And people don't even go to church and believe they're serving the Lord. They have no activity or where are engaged in the things that Christ Jesus called us to go and do in our Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and uttermost parts of the earth. And they've got a definition of serving God that does not even exist in the Bible. And they're deceived and they're on their way to an eternity without God. I don't care how special and precious you believe you are. I don't care if everybody in your lineage since Adam were preachers. You're not making heaven when you don't obey God. Just understand it. Get right. Because Father's word is it. God's word is the definition. Not my opinion, not your opinion, not anybody else's opinion. God's word is it. And praise God, Father has the people who speak his word faithfully. I mean, I've got to underscore it to you, because the kingdom of God is all fundamentally about doing that. And it's all about you and I in a place of dependency upon the Lord Jesus, for without him we could do nothing. It's about you and I being taught of the Holy Ghost and learning how to move with him and function in him and flow in him, because without the moving of the Holy Ghost through our life, in our midst and through us, we cannot in any way participate with what God demands. I give you all power and authority over all devils and all diseases. And then he says to them in this context, and so he then sent them to go and preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick, seeing that they had all authority and power over unclean spirits, over devils. And that is actually what then ultimately we hear the Lord Jesus Christ say in Acts chapter 1, verses 5 and verses 8, when he makes it very, very clear, in Luke chapter 24, verse 48, when he makes it very, very clear that we cannot be his witnesses until we're endued with power from on high, till we're given divine ability, because God has chosen that his gospel be preached with signs and wonders and miracles. That's why Paul said, when you want to define what Paul preached, he preached the kingdom of God. He went around preaching and telling people and ministering to people concerning the things of the kingdom of God. And how did he do it? He did it by Romans 15, 19, with signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power, so that the gospel was what? Fully preached. Fully preached. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, you're going to have to be willing to be taught with God. This is what prayer is all about.
Amen.
People say that they've lost their life. They don't even know how to lose their life enough to find a place of prayer. They've lost their life. They don't do their own will. They don't live their own life. They haven't even found enough losing their own life and not living for themselves that they have a consistent going through the Word of God. Come on, listen to me. I've read the Bible beyond more times than I can count. And I still am in the Word of God. I'm continuing the Word of God. Come on, people. I've translated most of the Bible. And write a whole commentary on the Bible. And I still have two Bible reading plans. Actually, I have three Bible reading plans right now. I have a Bible reading plan. I have a slow plan. No, I do. I have a plan, a year plan. I have a translation plan. Hallelujah. And you know, are you with me?
Yeah.
How many? I mean, I'm not trying to brag on me. I'm just trying to be an example to you. Come follow me. Because I'm living my life for the kingdom. I'm not living my life for myself. Somebody said, well, I'm so busy. You're so busy. You're too busy to go to heaven. You're too busy to be taught with God. You're too busy to be trained in the opportunity to take advantage of the fact that he's made it possible for you to be on a speaking level with him, on a conversation level with him, on a ask and receive, you know, relationship.
Amen.
Come on, people. That's got to be developed in our life.
Amen.
You know why I go to prayer? You know why I went to prayer last night? Because I know it's there where the Lord teaches me how to flow in the Holy Ghost. It's there where I'm taught how to allow the life and power of Jesus Christ to be revealed through me. It's there where I learn how to function and move in the Spirit. Hallelujah, because God is a Spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Otherwise, all you're doing is being taught to think like men, because all you can teach yourself is to think like men, and all your behavior and all your interaction is everything that is opposed to God. Listen to me now.
Yes.
I want to see you get saved tonight.
Amen.
Delivered out of the place where you live in your life for yourself.
Yes.
Delivered out of a realm where Satan can toss you to and fro. Live in a realm of hurt and rejection and torment where you never know how to engage in the very body of Christ. I'm going to tell you right now, if you're not in the church, listen to me, we watch it by web, you're not in the church, it's a manifest that you're not of us. And that's God speaking that you're not of us. It's one thing for me to say you're not of us, the body of Christ. It's another thing for God to say you're not of us, the family of God. And that you're out and you went out from among the church that you may be manifested that you're not of us. Hello. I love it when Jesus Christ has turned to us and said to us that he is our brother. I love that when Brother Yun said that when he was in the prison, the Lord said to him, Brother Yun. And it was Jesus talking to him. Isn't that great? He says to you, Brother Joshua, huh? Brother Brad, hallelujah. Brother Raphael, hallelujah. Sister Leslie, huh? Can you hear the Lord talking to you like that? Isn't that beautiful? It's wonderful to be on speaking terms with God. It's wonderful to have this kind of walking out relationship. I mean, day-to-day living together kind of relationship. Amen. Living in the same house. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. You lose your life and you're going to find abundant life. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. You lose your little old penny worth of a life and you're going to find a pearl of great price. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. You lose your copper piece. Yo, copper piece of a life, and you're going to find a treasure hidden in the field. Hallelujah. Potanaya. The Lord didn't downgrade us. Are you listening to me? People act like, oh, it's a downgrade. Downgrade. I got to go suffer now, live the life of Jesus. It's a downgrade. I had my life, now I'm going to go sacrifice. Go live the life of Jesus. My goodness, what on earth doctrine are you listening to? What devil's been preaching to you? This is the upgrade of the highest quality. I mean, we get the life of God. What an exchange. Hello! I got to lose my life. My goodness, people. Jesus, we understand things all wrong. We got the life of God. Praise God. Yippee! Praise the name of the Lord. I don't want mine anymore. Talk about lose it. Let's kick it out. Are you listening to me? Jesus. Hallelujah. Pandora pone shikane mea tota. Hallelujah. Hari mande steyota. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Look at this next chapter. Look at chapter 10. Well, Mandekano Soya. There's so many good things I have to look over, pass over to get over here. To think that you're going to enter into the realms of the kingdom of God, not labor, it's just so foreign to the scripture. No man having put his hand to the plow, looking back, is worthy of the kingdom of God. I mean, because somehow we can enjoy and taste the power of the world to come, and we think that we somehow value our life. Hold this open for me, my goodness. Somehow we taste the power of the worlds to come, the value and the beauty and the splendor of life, and decide that our life was better. That's terrible, man. This is an exciting life. It's a wonderful thing to tell, have devils obey you. It's a wonderful thing to see somebody all crippled and bound up come all of a sudden, walk, coming up out of that place of being bound and crippled, be made completely and totally whole. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hasta Hallelujah. 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 I hate to go all the way to verse 9 in the Luke in all the good things that Luke chapter 10 says, but go ahead and look at verse 9. He says, this is what he tells the disciples to do. He says, and heal the sick that are therein, and say unto them that the kingdom of God has come near to you. Look at here. This is the ministry of the kingdom of God. The taste of the kingdom of God is to see that veil between the seen and the unseen completely dissolved. And now begin to interact with that other realm that is there, that realm where Father is, that realm where the Holy Ghost is, that realm where Jesus is, that realm where Moses is, that realm where Elijah is, that realm where the horsemen of the Lord and the chariot thereof is. That realm where we see that there are more with us than are with them. That realm where we see that we're in the house of God and knew it not. Hey, I'm not that anymore. I'm in the house of God and know it. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. I have a revelation that he's there right there before me. I see him. He's on my right hand that I should not be moved. That's the kind of relationship that Father wants to develop us in when we go to the Word and when we go to prayer. And then when we begin to put, you know, movement to our prayer and movement to the things that God has said to us and declared to us in his Word. And suddenly we begin to live out the wonderful, abundant God kind of life with his divine power and authority being revealed through our life. It's not going to happen while you continue on charting your own course and expect to end up at God's destination. You will not. You will not. Satan is a master of his craft. He would deceive you. The only thing that will keep you from deception is the Word of God and the Spirit of God. And the only way that and it's not just, well, I'm reading the Word of God for protection. No, it's the Word of God doing the Word of God, because when you're doing the Word of God, then you're not going to get deceived. If you're just reading the Word of God, it has no profit to you because you're hearers only and not doers. Huh? God told us that we were born, had to be born of the Spirit to be able to see or understand the kingdom. We had to be born of the Spirit to enter into the realm of the kingdom. Now, there is a realm of the kingdom of God that we will go into in the future. Hallelujah. Yes. That flesh and blood cannot inherit. But there is a realm of the kingdom of God that we've been translated into right now and are supposed to operate in right now. And you can read about that in Romans chapter 14, verse 17. For Paul said, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but it's righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. So he described to us that interaction with the Holy Ghost is kingdom of God stuff. And the fruit and evidence of interaction with the Holy Ghost is righteousness, joy, and peace. Now, I mean, how many days are you going to live without that and go ahead and be happy with it and say that you've lost your life and you're living Jesus' life? Because people live out a life of total ignorance and darkness. That means that you've got things going on in your life and you don't even see them or observe them or recognize them. Come on, God didn't make us ostriches. He made us human beings. He didn't make us those who... And then we graduated from being human beings to be heirs of God and co-inheritors with Jesus, to be people of the Spirit. Amen. Born of the Spirit. Hallelujah. To live in the Spirit. To walk in the Spirit. Jesus said, if I cast out devils by the Spirit of God, in Luke chapter 12 and verse 21, he said, then the kingdom of God has come to you. Huh? So he told the disciples, go preach the kingdom of God and do what? Cast out devils. Hallelujah. People want to just have, they want to have a kingdom of God without the Holy Ghost. They want to have a kingdom of God without signs and wonders. They want to have a church without the miracles and without the gifts of healing and the tongues and interpretation of tongues that God has placed within the midst of the church. It is totally a farce. It's totally a deception. It is another Jesus. It is another church. It is another covenant. Because by definition, it is anti-Christ. It is anti-God's word. It is men's opinion. I watched as people just the slow bleed on Sunday night. As people weren't getting their expectations out of Brother Yun. And by the time that Brother Yun is done, he slips out and even more slip out. Then I watched as people begin to, as their ears picked up and perked up and their little antennas came out because they heard somebody go, Vastarabadi. Because they want church with no manifestation of the Holy Ghost. They want church without righteousness. They want church called with unrighteousness. We all unrighteous, no, not one. Does this sound familiar? Yeah. That's Antichrist. Yeah. They want church without joy. Don't give me no joy. Don't give me no joy. Joy is just to read, not to have. Rejoice forevermore. That isn't joy like you're having. It's not that kind of joy. It's not joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's just joy, 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 down in my heart. Down, down, way down. Down in my heart. The Lord tells you and I, so these signs shall follow them that believe. So then are you willing to live without it? Yes, some people are. Some people in here are. When's the last time you cast out a devil? These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they'll cast out devils. When's the last time you cast out a devil? When's the last time you agreed with a devil? Ruh-roh. Because to sin and to disobedience, you have to agree with the devil. You have to agree with the demon spirit. Somebody said we're supposed to sin more or less every day. Yeah, that's what God said. He said, yeah, I'm going to give you a more or less every day. I'm going to give you some days power and authority over devils. I mean, we have to change. Listen now, we have to radically change the word of God. I give you authority occasionally to tread upon scorpions and serpents, but don't expect it every day. From time to time, you shall have authority and power. It's special events of my sovereign moving over all unclean spirits. We have to radically change the Bible. We have to radically change what Jesus said to fit the way that we live it. If you're going to hunger and thirst after righteousness, that is by definition hungering and thirsting after the dimension of that which Father is, what He's doing, what He wants, what it is He's expressing. If you're going to hunger and thirst after the kingdom of God, if you're going to seek first the kingdom of God, you're going after something that is a totally different dimension of the way that people want to live their life. It is a continual interaction with the realms of the Holy Ghost. Mazita la mojika. And then what happens is people are willing, people in here, you're willing to let the enemy get an advantage over you, and you're willing to tolerate something less. And you just get all discouraged, and you act like somehow that the Lord doesn't love you, and you've been left out. You know, that fundamentally is unrighteousness, because righteousness was first expressed within the context of obeying and trusting God, because it was accounted under Abraham for righteousness because he believed God. And think about the cost, and think about the obedience that was there. Because people want to say, well, it's counted, you know, our faith is accounted unto us as righteousness, and they want to put it in a context as though just because you believe something, because you have certain imaginations about something, that somehow that results in righteousness. No, that's not the context at all. It's hearing the word of God and doing the word of God, and look at the consequences, and look at the risk, and look at the obedience that Abraham went through with God at the call from the time he was 75 years old, when the Lord told him to leave the place of his homeland, to leave and go into a foreign place that he didn't even know he was going. Look at all the obedience and all the consecration and all the commitment that came along with that belief that was accounted unto him for righteousness. Amen. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
It is a fellowship with the Lord of trusting him to say, wait a minute, I'm not going to allow the accuser of my soul to condemn me and to browbeat me and make me feel like that somehow I'm left out. I recognize that this is the call of God for my life, and he's wanting me to come over here and pursue and place a demand on this and be urgent about it and to plead about it. That's what supplication means, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Supplication comes from a Greek word that means to plead with urgency. Like, so the house is burning down, and so you got to get out now. I mean, when's the last time you had that kind of prayer going on by the Spirit on the inside of you to be able to interact in the kingdom of God realm? Think about it, people. I'm dealing with your stuff called lukewarmness. I'm dealing with your stuff called unbelief. I'm dealing with your stuff called unwillingness to pursue God. Because Father is a rewarder of those who pursue him, who seek him, who hunger and thirst, who are diligent, who give all diligence. That's what he says over and again. And I pray tonight that you recognize, really, if you define, as I said at the very, very beginning, if you define things for yourself correctly as God has defined them, then you're not going to be deceived about calling something or experience that you have that which God wants when it's not even close. Because it was purely subjective, is what you imagined in your mind was acceptable to God. That is influenced by the prince of the power of the air, the god of this world, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. That is influenced by a person who is a master of his craft and deception. There is only one defense against a lie, that which Satan is propagating, and that's the truth of God's word.
Amen.
And as for me, I need continually, even though I memorized whole books of the Bible, I continually need the word of God. I continually feast on the word of God. Even though I can start reading the word of God in many places, and I can just turn my face away and continue to read it because I've memorized it already, I still need to recite it. Hallelujah. Because there's something about the reciting of it. It's not just having it in the memory banks and I think it. I need to recite it because it does something different in my life. I'm just telling you. I know that what's going on in my life is supposed to go on in your life because it's what's going on in my life is that which God's word described. His word works mightily on the inside of us. His word is something that we're supposed to desire because it works within us a growth and a maturation. If we'll recite his word day and night, the scripture tells us that then we'll be successful and we'll be very courageous and we'll inherit those things that Father has promised for us to have. Amen. Recite it, meditate on his word or recite his word day and night that you may observe to do all that he has written. All that is written. God's saying today, yesterday, and forever. He wants us to observe all that is written. He wants us to be doers of the word. The living word came and revealed the written word. He said, here it is. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, one time somebody prophesied over me and said, I see the anointing I don't know what it was, baby. It was something like about Job. What was it? It was something like, I see the mantle of Job or something like that. And Ann got upset. She's like, mantle of Job? I'm not going to curse God and die. Right? And so she's got all the negative stuff going down. Right? We're going to lose everything and then God's going to give it back to us sevenfold. And I'd have her, huh? You could double. Twofold, thank you. I love that, thank you. But I said, no, baby, you took that wrong. You took it wrong. Look here. God's got his last champion. It's all settled. There's no need for a contest anymore. Jesus comes full of principalities. He come condemn sin in the flesh. He came and proved it once and for all, and then spoiled principalities and powers, making an open shame of them. But that doesn't mean that you can't be taken captive by their will, because it still goes on. That's still just as much a reality. Oh, is it a finished work? Is it finished at the cross? Absolutely. But the war still goes on. And that's why the Lord says, be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might, because you are coming up against spiritual wickedness. You wrestling. It's hand-to-hand combat. Somebody said, how can it be both? It sounds like a paradox. Not a paradox. It's not a paradox at all. God finished the work that so you and I could step over into the realms of glory and be holy and acceptable and everything that God's ever wanted us to be, because we find ourselves in Christ Jesus with all power and authority now to effectively deal a death blow to Satan every time he comes up against us and everywhere we see him, in every life that he's possessing, in every life that he's oppressing. That's our job. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father's just working this on me too, to where that I don't get into any kind of a human framework or human reference where, you know, you see a demonic spirit on somebody and then you try to get all human with them, you know, and try to relate to them on a human level, because what you do is you absolutely forfeit the realms of divine authority to deal with that demon power. You got to come at it with boldness and say, listen, I want to break this yoke off of you that I see it's manifested. If God's going to reveal it to you, don't you understand that he revealed it to you so that you could have authority over it to make it, you know, to tell it to go? Hey, and what happens is we try to uphold each man's dignity and guard each man's pride. Are you listening to me? Yeah. We try to humanize the things of God inside of, you know, okay, I want you to relax and, you know, don't get upset about what I'm getting ready to tell you, but I'm going to cast the devil out of you, you know, kind of thing. And that what we do is we literally forfeit authority. We need to stop trying to function on a human level and a Holy Ghost level at the same time. We kingdom of God people to go everywhere preaching the kingdom of God. And if I cast out devils by the Holy Ghost, then the kingdom of God has come to you. And God has commissioned me to go and preach everywhere the gospel of the kingdom. Amen. To heal the sick, to cast out devils, and say the kingdom of God has come near unto you. And this is what you're supposed to do. You sit here and smile at me tonight and don't go do it, then you need serious straighten out. You need somebody, you know, and you say, well, I'm fearful. Yeah, it's because that's a demonic power oppressing you. And Father's giving you the ability to deal with that demonic spirit. Hallelujah. You know, I when I find myself in a situation where I look at what's before me and I go, I don't even know where to begin. I don't even, like, you could just imagine, let's just look at your neighborhood. You look at your neighborhood and everybody, you know, they've got fence gates in front of the door. And they got a big sign that says, no solicitors. And that means no preaching. I don't want nothing. Stay away. Dog. Smith & Wesson. Whatever it is. You know, the whole thing. Right? You just like that. It's just a fence city. And you go, you just see what you have to do is you have to be willing to say, Father, I don't even know where to begin here. I know what you want. I know that you want me to touch their lives with your glory and with your power, but I don't know where to begin. And then what's happened, if you're not careful, you'll just go, Lord, I don't even know where to begin here, so I'm stopping now. That's what happened. Basically, you won't say that, but that's conscious. I don't even know where to begin. Father, this is the finished wall and finished city. I don't even know where to start. Amen. And you don't pray about it ever again. But whenever it's a reality in your soul, then you recognize, wait a minute, I am sin to my neighbors. I'm sin to my community. I'm sin to those that are around me. I'm looking for divine opportunity. And I know the how it's supposed to go down. It's not supposed to go down. Here, I'd like to give you this little gospel track. You know, this little kid's good. You know, just kind of, you get a chance, perhaps, opportunity to sit down and read it. It only take you like, oh, maybe 2 or 3 minutes. And it's kind of cool because see the cartoons in it? Then the Lord said, I want you to go and preach the gospel with chick tracks. Because we reduce the gospel of the kingdom. I want you to go to preach the gospel in here. I'm going to give you a dozen different icebreakers. How is the weather? Did you watch the football game last night? Or whatever it is. He said signs and wonders and miracles. He said authority and power against unclean spirits. I want you to have authority. I don't want you to look like a scribe. I don't want you to look like some little religious idiot. That somebody can walk right off. I want you to stand up straight. I want you some fire in your eyes. I want some fire in your belly. And I want you to talk at this thing as though it's me speaking and addressing your life. Well, you're gonna have to work that out in your prayer room. And I hope it don't take you another 10 years. Amen. You know, people can write off a couple of us, call us professional Kingdom of God people. Professional Christians. They're really good at what they do. But it's about time for the church to rise up. Amen. Yes. Huh? Yeah. It's about time for you to learn how to talk with God. Amen. Let me tell you right now, there's some people, I want to be able to tell them, your tongues is like, you know, fingernails on a chalkboard. Yeah. Your tongues. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But you can't. There's a restriction because all they're going to do is go spiral down into a deeper depth of discouragement. They're just stuck. I'm about to get people unstuck. You know what I'm asking the Lord to give me a special grace to do? Get people unstuck. Amen. I want to be so detached from any human concern. I'm just going to tell it like it is. Huh? Come on, people. People are ducking and diving. I mean, so many times I've called for people to receive things of the Spirit. And the people that need it most sitting back there looking like, what is that? Is that a display of defiance or are you clueless? Because it's one of the two, because it ain't full of the Holy Ghost. It ain't full of the Holy Ghost. Maybe there is a possibility of deception that you feel like you're full of the Holy Ghost and that you are doing signs and wonders and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost in power, but that's something that's going on in your imagination. Because there are people, I've heard of them, that are legends in their own mind. Their imagination is beyond all comprehension. To have no distinction between imagination and reality, dream and reality. Are you with me? Yeah. It's a sad thing. I want you to get real with God so we can talk to you. Amen. You get real with God and someone can come talk to you and tell you, no, you can't do it that way. Don't do it that way. That's wrong. Do this. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, we're going to lay hands on you right now and help you. Amen. And then you say, do you know you need help? And when you have to say that, you know what? They do not know they need help. As soon as I'm inspired to say, do you know you need help? I know right there. They don't know they need help. And what they're going to do is they're going to go home, and now they're going to get themselves into a worse condition and situation because all they're going to do is talk bad about God's Holy Ghost work in their life or trying to work. And they're going to speak against the Spirit of the Lord. And so, thus is the saga of the church. It is. Ask any anointed pastor. This is the saga of the church. And we in conflict against those things where people are not willing to be doers, they just hear and hear and hear and hear and hear and let somebody else do their work. Go do my work for me. Would you do my work for me? People, it's time you get real. Because if you get real about God, with God, and you start doing the word, you start going out into Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, uttermost parts of the earth, you give yourself to the kind of ministry that Father has called us to, you know what you're going to find real quickly? You're going to find a prayer life. You know why? Because you're going to confront your desperate need. My goodness, I am just powerless. I don't even have enough anointing. Yeah, are you listening to me?
Yeah.
To get the devil to even growl. Yeah. I have enough anointing to just disturb him. Yeah. Didn't even disturb him. At least get enough anointing to aggravate the devil. Amen. So he manifests a little bit. Amen. And it will put you in a place where you, and if you don't get discouraged, if you don't become overwhelmed to go, no, I must somehow be left out. There's something wrong with me. Oh, you know, and go down that road where the enemy's lying to you and you're listening. But you get real with God. You say, Holy Ghost, I want to get this right. I know you've called me to do this. I know you've given power and authority to do it. I want to be taught of you. And then you get, that's where the prayer life begins to be now vital. It becomes vitalized, empowered. Now you're desperate. Now there's a desperate sound in your voice. Oh, God,
yes.
I felt so bad. I looks like I made you look terrible today. And I looked worse. I've been there, people. I've been there. I've come from a meeting and thrown myself down on the ground and go, oh, God, I am pathetic. I promised everybody they're going to get healed. I don't think nobody got healed. I spoke your word. Nothing happened. But you know what I found? I found how to move with the Spirit. I found how to move with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I found a realm of a relationship and a realm of authority. Hallelujah. So will you.
Amen.
But until you get in the throat, once again, it's never, nothing's ever going to change. You'll never know your need. You'll go along pretending that you've got it all. You got nothing. And you'll fit right in with God's description in Revelation chapter 3. Blind, wretched, naked, poor and miserable. And all the time you think you can see and you say you're clothed and you say you're rich and have need of nothing. See, I took that verse of scripture personal for me one day. And I said, oh, God, I don't want to be lukewarm. God, I don't want to be unfruitful. You told me that I wouldn't be unfruitful. I'm going to be fruitful. You demanded fruitfulness. And then I want to just try to wrap this up. And this didn't go down the way I thought it was going to go down with great clarity and plainness of speech in the way that I thought it would happen. But I think there was still clarity and plainness of speech in the way that God had purposed for it to happen, the way it needed to happen tonight with the dynamics of who's here. Who's been here and who's here now. But the Lord Jesus said in Matthew chapter 21, he said concerning Israel, he said, I'm taking the kingdom of God from Israel. The kingdom of God was a mantle, an authority, a covenant relationship that Father had given to Israel. And I don't believe that there's any chapter of the Bible that more highlights that better than Deuteronomy chapter 28. I'll make you the head over all nations. You'll be subservient to no one. And you listed all the blessings of God and all the authority and all the splendor and all the glory and majesty that God vested within a family, within Israel as a nation. He said, I'm going to take the kingdom from you because you're not bringing forth the fruits of it. Because those fruits have already been laid out. They've already been described by the Lord. And then what Christ Jesus did was he took those fruits and those expressions of the kingdom of God to a whole nother level. And he said, I'm going to give it to a nation that will bring forth the fruits. And what did he say concerning the church? He said, the church is a holy nation. We are royal priesthood. I mean, God has given to us a place of divine authority, a kingly majesty, a priestly anointing.
Amen.
And somehow we've deprioritized that. We've not known how to lay hold on that life. We've not known, we've not been willing to be taught how to move in that realm of faith. Listen, faith was given to you. A measure of faith was given to you for one purpose. A measure of faith was given to you for one purpose, so that it could grow and increase. I'm going to say it one more time. I got two amens, three nods, 100 bow your heads and look to the ground. A measure of faith was given to you so that it may grow and increase and develop. This way you only need a seed of it, because it'll turn into everything that you'll ever have. It will turn into the supply of everything you have need of. As a tree that fills the whole earth. As a provision that fills the whole earth. You got to start moving. Because where's the heart of the Father? Do you know where the heart of the Father is? It's exactly what you did when you got in your car and you drove up, started ministering to your family that was in the hospital. That's where the heart of the Father is. He goes right to the sick. He goes right to the lost. His heart is at the lost. Are you going to say that you're serving God and you're not willing to lose your life enough to go and connect with the heart of the Father and go to the lost? We're somehow. These things are going to get cleared up. These things got to get cleared up. Because I ask people, I watch it, and how long have you been serving the Lord? They tell me, well, I've been serving the Lord for 30 years. You're kidding me. You got that many devils in you. I mean, that's really what I want to say. Because they've got a wrong definition of what it means to serve the Lord. They never had a burden for the lost. They never lost their life. They hold on to their life. They hold on to their life so much, God, the Holy Ghost can't teach them nothing. Because if he says anything, they get all offended. Because the pride of life has such a strong hold upon them. Huh? You can't give someone who's a fool instruction. And a fool is one dominated by the pride of life. You can't give them instruction. You got to get broken and humble to be able to receive the instruction of God's wisdom. To be able then to be taught how to go after the lost, to learn how to flow and function in the Holy Ghost. God, the Holy Ghost, is not going to begin to move through you and teach you anything until you learn how to be broken and contrite before Him. And that's what the Spirit of the Lord come to teach us. He's going to teach us how to walk in lowliness and meekness, and the value of it. And the value, and it's really developed when we're in the throes of it. And somebody reading us the Riot Act and telling us, don't have that in your life. People have told me, asked me at different times, listen, I want you to mentor me. I'd like to, you know, really come and be a disciple. And my first response to them, I usually don't say it, is, no, you don't. You wouldn't last a week. You would not last a week. You would not last a week of how I can talk to Joshua and how he responds. You would not last a week with me. You wouldn't last a week with the Holy Ghost. He's got to do a protracted thing. We're just sitting here waiting for a little bit of humility so we can talk. We're waiting for a one moment of breakthrough of brokenness so we can slide into just a little bit of help. No, I'm telling you, this is the truth. This is the truth. But I pray tonight in the name of Jesus that everybody in this place, that you say, nope, that ain't going to be me. That ain't going to be me. Hallelujah. Parastiki na matea. That ain't going to be me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody said, well, if I just knew you loved me, like Joshua knows that you love him, I could take it. Well, no. Let's look at another dynamic. Do you know that God the Father loves you? Because really, that's where the problem is. Because if you know he loves you, hallelujah, he's going to take really good care of you. See, as he brought you here and everything. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. See, as he made me your pastor. Amen. Made me a shepherd over your soul. Hallelujah. Well, you reckon that you can trust God and not believe that? I tell you, you can't. You're fooling yourself. You're fooling yourself. It all just comes back down to how much relationship you have with him, how much you believe that he loves you, how much you really believe that he's involved in your life, that he cares for you, that he watches over you, gives no slumber nor sleep. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Mandos te kepasta. Porosete namast. Menende sitaya. Simembrivetesti. Halamokarade. Halamokara sipane. Halamokaraba sitanamo. Halabokana masaya. Halabokaramea. Hatori masiti liatalanamo. He sirinando koshti. Let me hear you. Let me tell you something. Don't you try to pray in tongues over top of unrepented sin. You better get yourself some God fear. Amen. Fear of the Lord and God consciousness. Amen. The blood of Jesus Christ is there to cleanse you from all sin. Amen. Well, you can't just walk over top of it. You can't just act like it ain't there. Yeah. You've lived wrong. You've done things wrong. You better come to Him in repentance.
Amen.
And that's a brokenness. Yeah. If you don't have brokenness over sin, it ain't repentance. It ain't repentance at all. You allow things in your life, you just get real with God, you get broken over, you say, Father, forgive me. I can't believe I've allowed this to happen. Lord Jesus, I just thank you for your precious blood that cleanses me. You get serious with God. And I mean, He'll cleanse you right there on the spot and remember it no more. But you can't just, you know, people who develop lives where they just basically allow sin, they don't get broken over sin, they just kind of try to pray right over top of it.
Right.
Seared conscience. Yeah. Pat was telling me the other day he's going to start running to the churches with a new message. I said, and when he told me the message, I said, my goodness, that's amazing. They're going to let you in? And he's just talking about how people worship and praising God over top of all kinds of sin and iniquity because of a seared conscience. Yeah. Don't you do that. You get right with God, you repent. When you repent, you tell the Lord, I'm never doing this again. By your heaven, your grace, I'm never doing this again. That's just God's goodness. And you might have to come back the 100th time saying, God, I'm never going to do this again. I mean, because some people are slow learners, I reckon. Why? Because they've never learned how to go to a secret place. They've never learned how to be developed in the Spirit of the Lord. They never learned how to be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of His might because they never learned a place of prayer. No one taught them there that. No one placed a demand upon them, the requirement. You know what God told me to do? He said, for me to teach you to observe all things that He has commanded. And what happens now, we live in a dynamic of where the church and people in the church are so defiant and so rebellious, and they want to have it their own way. As soon as someone comes out with that kind of authority to teach you to do it God's way, to correct you when you're wrong, people exit the door. Where's the exit sign? You see one there, and you see one there, and there's one there. Three exit signs. They go on three different directions. They're then going, not going that way. It's true. It's the crisis of the church. Don't you allow it in your life. Don't you participate with those things that I just named, that I just spent the past 15 minutes talking about. Because Father's called you to come into the kingdom of God, to be trained in the kingdom of God, to be developed in authority. Look at it. Look at the disciples. Look at how perfect they were when He gave them power and authority. They far from perfect. Are you listening to me? They were far from perfect. He gave power and authority to people that were going to forsake Him and deny Him, and He knew it. But He vested them with power and authority because He'll start with those. He'll start with us right where we're willing to go with Him in. They were at least willing. They, in their imperfection, in their inability that they had, in their frailty and weakness, at least they were willing to forsake all and lose their life and come follow Jesus. They had to leave everything. It was just as difficult for them. They had bills to pay. It was just difficult, just as difficult. They'd spent their whole life fishing, making a living fishing. And anybody who's ever made a living fishing, you know right now, you don't catch enough fish to last for the year. Huh? You basically are week from week, month to month kind of thing, paycheck to paycheck. Thank you, Jesus. So tonight, the Father is just asking you, he's made a request of you. And I want you to understand very clearly what He's made a request of you about. He's asking you, are you willing to serve Him? To serve the Lord. And do you understand what it means to serve the Lord? Are you willing to be taught how to function and live in the realms of the kingdom of God? And do you understand that that is the activity of the supernatural, the realm of interacting with the unseen, the glory of God? Hallelujah. That belongs to righteousness and joy and peace in the Holy Ghost. That belongs to authority and power over unclean spirits. It belongs to preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. It belongs to giving yourself to these things with all diligence so that he can minister an entrance into you, into this realm of his divine glory, of his everlasting kingdom. Is it the most important thing that you might be learned and be taught of the Holy Ghost, how to function in this realm, how to function in spirit knowledge so that you can speak to a rock and water come out. You can say to an axe head float and it obeys. Hallelujah. Say to the sun and the moon, don't move it, and it has to listen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the name of Jesus. So that you can go everywhere setting people free, that you won't be unfruitful. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You don't live to please yourself. You live to please him. You don't live to do your own stuff. You learn to do his stuff.
Amen.
Live to do his stuff.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Bicando Stepani. Hallelujah. Si pombra de tefi. Monashitea. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
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 Bataya. Mandabrate. Mambravatana. Hallelujah. Father wants you to experience enough of his presence so you can't live without it.
Amen.
So go ahead. Just go ahead right now. So everybody stand with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pandorusha kinama. Pandorusha pikinama. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Sukambra de vete de beta la masa to lola batevre de vica shishata la bost. Pie pretest. Prando de viciste de dea talanana na mosanda la dea. Hey, listen, you know, Randy just handed me this. He put this together. It says, see what all these say about me. Oh, man, don't put all this stuff on the back here. Would you take this stuff about me off the back of there? It's for heaven's sakes. Bless your heart. But all the rest of it's good. The rest of it's great. You don't have any too many copies of this, do you? Ann wants it, but... No, this is my translation of the book of Ephesians with commentary. And, Randy's made it available. Bless you, Randy. He's made it available in hard copy. You can download it for free. People say, I want to go to Bible school. I want to learn the Word of God. Listen, you know what? We have meetings going here almost every night. Tuesday night women's meeting, Wednesday night the service, Thursday night, youth meetings, Friday night, School of the Spirit, Saturday night, School of Music, School of Worship, huh? Sunday, you know what goes on then? We got a website that you'll spend several years getting through. And it's online tutor. Because there's a little button that says, email pastor. And you can say, hey, I just got finished with this one word. I can't even pronounce it, but here it is, cut and paste. Can you help me? Sure. And I'm telling you, because, you know, for me, I take my job seriously. And, you know, I'm going to do everything I possibly can do to make sure that you have everything that you need to be taught all those things which God has held us responsible for. We are mentoring. We're mentoring. I don't know anybody who mentors more than we do. I don't know anybody who puts forth more resources and more things on available on a daily basis. And I pray that you'll take advantage of it. I pray that you understand that the kingdom of God is worth giving your whole life, investing your whole life and time into. And that you'll understand that it's more practical application than anything, because I know folks that know just a little bit about the Bible, but they're reaching tens of thousands of souls. Some people are doing it almost on a one-on-one basis. They're just so busy in the kingdom. Village to village, town to town, in third world countries. Get little groups of people together. Get everybody saved, baptized. Amen. You can do that. You just got to go hunting. Just go hunting. Say, hey, how are you doing today? Versus doing good. Say, well, I'm just out searching for people who want to know God. And some people say, I don't want that. But you'll find people go, what? Tell me about that. What are you talking about? Then at that very moment, the anointing will come upon you. Power of God will come upon you. First thing you do is you address the powers of darkness. God gives you wisdom and insight on how to do it. And you set them free right there. As soon as they want to hear, it ain't a mind to mind. It ain't flesh to flesh. It ain't head to head. It ain't football. Are you with me? It's now understanding how to move in power and authority. And the first part of power and authority is recognizing what God said and who He is. Recognizing it is there. Recognizing this is what He wants me to do. This is how He wants me to do it. That's 99% of it. 99%. I know, Father, my behavior, my posture, how I'm supposed to behave right now, what I'm supposed to do. I'm supposed to move in power and authority. Father, I thank you for the power. So whispering on my breath. Father, thank you for power and authority of the Holy Ghost. You don't jump on them and tackle them, obviously. But the anointing comes upon you. The Spirit of the Lord just gives it right there to you. You know exactly where to move. And you're going after, not an education ceremony.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
But a miracle of a new birth.
Amen.
This is the definition of revival and great awakening. This is it. It ain't going to happen because you're sitting around waiting for somebody else to do something sometime, someplace, somewhere. Oh, God. Somehow David interacted enough with the Holy Ghost to recognize, to receive a boldness to take out a bear. To where that his value of the sheep was so great that he risked his life against a bear. Bear is no easy prey. No easy prey. Then he spent enough time and still spending enough time in the Holy Ghost, he takes out a lion. Once again, he just graduated. Father, I just want you to come to understand how wonderful it is to enjoy His presence. How much He delights to see His people enjoying His presence. Father looks and He watches and He sees how we're willing to just go on without His presence, go on without interaction with Him. And I'm telling you right now, that speaks volumes in heaven. Don't allow that to be your testimony of what you're speaking. Don't allow that to be what you're saying. You've got to recognize how practical sometimes dealing with the powers of darkness is. because it can come right down to that you're tired, you don't feel inspired, just like you're overwhelmed. Suddenly, you got all this energy. Now, suddenly it's prayer time, you're all tired and everything. What's up with that? You got to break through that mess. And it can be broken through. It'd come and it'd turn all the way around. Yeah. Suddenly prayer time would come. Instead of you being all tired and sleepy, you energized.
Yeah.
It'd turn completely around. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You know, I feel deep in my spirit right now. I feel deep in my spirit right now. The need for some people in this place to really just turn your life over to Jesus. I can feel it deep in the spirit. Jesus. And I want you to know, I'm going to tell you people, I'm just so blessed. I was so blessed on Sunday night. The Abiding Place Ministry standing here. Those of you here up here in front, just participating with pressing into that realm of divine glory. And then just standing there in the presence of the Lord, dancing around a bit in the presence of the Lord, because that's just Holy Ghost. There's no human in it, as it were. Father has that for you all the time. But there's others in here tonight. There's just places you've just not been willing to serve the Lord. You know, here's how most people hear it. When we say, are you serving the Lord? They immediately start thinking about how much sin they got going on in their life. And then they've got that measured out. And the things are so wrong, they're just so sideways. Serving the Lord is about you and I surrendering our life to live His life. And then that takes care of all the rest of the stuff. That takes care of all the rest of the stuff. People over here working on this thing about service. No, come on. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Tonight, Father's crying out to you. He's calling out to you once again. He's calling you to come. Maybe you're listening by the web right now. He's calling you to surrender. He's calling you to come into His presence to learn how good He is. He's calling you to come into His presence to understand the life He has for you. Then it's no problem for you to stop living your own life. Then suddenly it's not this big, gigantic sacrifice. It's not this upheaval in your life where you now got to somehow take a lesser course of existence. Would you come? Tonight, would you come? Would you come to Jesus? Tonight, would you come? Would you just come to Jesus? Even right there in your living room, you're watching, just come to Jesus. You need to get in church. The church would not even exist. The church would not even be able to function if everybody stayed at home and watched on the web. Just would not even be able to function. So if you do something, if you allow something in your life that would result in the church not even being able to function if everybody did what you're doing, then you got to understand that that's wrong behavior. And that you prioritize your life above the kingdom and above the things of God. And you would say, well, I don't have gas money, or I'm tired, or this and that. Listen, the Lord wants to heal you and He wants to provide for you. And He said, you seek first the kingdom of God and I will provide for you. You know, what I believe that's going on is those that are coming right now is that you're saying that you're going to start doing the work of the kingdom. That's obviously why you're coming up here. You're saying, I'm not going to run the risk of living my own life and trying to pretend that I've lost my life when I'm living my own life. When Jesus made it very clear in the right context in Mark chapter 8, verses 33 through 37, he made it very clear, even a baby can understand it. And you're going to find where you can live out your life in the kingdom in a realm of prayer. You're going to find out where you can live your life in the kingdom in the study of the Word, because, my goodness, if you don't have the Word in you, what are you going to go tell people? Because it's only the Word that's going to break off the yoke off their lives. But if you don't have the flow of the Holy Ghost in your life, the Word ain't going to do nothing but kill. It ain't going to do nothing but alienate people. You say, well, I talk to a lot of people, but there's no one out there that wants to accept Jesus. Well, you know what? That ain't right. Something's wrong there. Because the masses need him. They're looking for him. If everyone's standing here tonight, up here tonight, if you will allow the fire of the Holy Ghost to produce in your life that for which he was given. This time next year, you'll have dozens of people standing around you that you brought into the kingdom. You'll have dozens of people. You'll start telling me about certain ministries that we need. Yes, you will. Yes, you will. But it takes an anointing to reach the lost. You can't do it on your inability. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It takes an anointing to stand on a platform with a crowd of lost people to see that they're not going to just come respond because they're in the meeting and you're on the platform. That anointing was developed one-on-one on the streets. That anointing was developed by doing the work of the ministry long before you ever got on that platform. If God takes you to the platform, there's some people God never takes them to the platform in that sense, because you just called to be an evangelist one-on-one or one-on-ten or whatever. But not to say that the Lord couldn't enlarge that for every single person and put everybody on the platform. He could. And not limit him. Jesus. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you. Thank you, Father. The dynamics of this, the most important part of this, is going to be realized in your prayer closet. You must understand this tonight, dear people. Your growth and maturity in God is a reflection of how much time every day you're willing to spend with Him. It really is. Of how much you're willing to take the risk and step out and begin to do those things which God's called you to do. And those two things serve each other. Prayer serves the stepping out, and stepping out serves the prayer. As you step out and you realize how much more you need. But it doesn't take long. It doesn't take 6 months.
Amen.
It doesn't take 3 years.
Amen.
It might have taken 3 years for the apostles, but we on the expedited program.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It won't take no 3 years. It takes a day.
Yes.
A Pentecost day.
Yes.
And a response.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now, right now where you're standing, right now where you're standing, I want you to understand this. Whether you're watching Mother Weber or you're standing here in this place, I want you to understand the provision of God is there for you right now. It's not... It's not about whether you fall down, stand up, jump, shout, run. It's about the fact that God has established this. His word has gone forth. The Holy Ghost is here.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let me just tell you, Father makes this fun. No, He makes this really exciting. When you first look at it, you're intimidated about it. You try to think through it. It doesn't work. No. Father makes us so full of life. So full of divine power and authority. It's not awkward. You know what? If it's awkward, just stop. Go back to the prayer room. Just go back to the prayer room. Just don't do nothing. It's like getting ready to, it would be like getting ready to stand up and preach, and all you do is feel awkward. You don't even know what you're going to do. You just feel like all self-conscious. Everybody's staring at me. You with me?
Yeah.
Don't even get up on the platform. Please, this is going to be terrible. Go pray in the Holy Ghost till you all of a sudden receive an authority and a boldness.
Amen.
And I'm not talking about getting on the platform. I'm talking about go praying and anointing. Pray in the Holy Ghost till you receive an authority and anointing to not be awkward as you're talking to someone.
Yes. Yes. Amen.
If you will, you know, if you will, the Lord will start pointing out to you people, and you just say, Lord, I want a divine appointment today.
Yeah.
And you get real earnest about it, and then He's going to start pointing people out to you. You're going to have a divine appointment. Regardless of how it works out, you've had a divine appointment. You know you have a divine appointment. What's going to happen, because you give yourself to that every day, you're going to start walking around and you're going to have all kinds of divine appointments, because it's like you just got a discerning of everything that's going on. It's just coming at you right, left, and center. You could stop people all along the way and say, hey, I mean, just so many things that God would reveal. You could almost just tell them their life story. One after another. But that doesn't begin that way. It develops some of that. Somebody said, oh, well, you lay your hands on me, so I have a special ability to do that. You have a special ability to go show people the love of God.
Amen.
That is huge.
Amen.
And then as you do that, Father gives you special giftings and special abilities and grows it and matures it. He gives you a measure of faith so that it grow and increase. And it grows and increases into the realms of the manifestation of signs, wonders, and the demonstration of the power of the Holy Ghost on the display of what is essential for preaching the gospel of the kingdom, to do it His way. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just letting this soak here. I'm just letting this soak in here. You know what Papa's got to do? I mean, because I've watched it not only in my life, but in the life of those who I've read about, and in those who are in the church, in the testimonies in the Bible. You got to let God break you. You got to be broken. Because if you've got a lot of self-confidence and self-worth, and you're really proud of yourself, God the Holy Ghost can't flow through that. He can't. He's not going to mix it up. You got to be broken. And sometimes we go through so many challenges and failures, as it were, and we just don't succeed at it because we need to be broken. We finally get so, we come to the limits of our human ability. We go, wait a minute. I used to be really proud of myself. And I don't feel the same way about me no more. This is going to be really easy now to deny me. Before, it was really a hard concept. Denying me is a tough thing.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Broken. broken. Break the alabaster box, Lord. That the sweet anointing of your presence and that which blesses you flows out of me. Ooh. And in this place, he gives us a brokenness, a humility that has a great boldness with it. And he gives us a meekness that has a great confidence. Can you hear me, Ruth? Can you hear me? It is so heartbreaking to look at the massive numbers of youth right now, which we would call the millennials, as they believe in a cause called socialism and communism. They've not had any other cause. They're looking for a cause. The things that are around them, the status quo stuff that are around them, is just totally obnoxious to them. Religion is obnoxious to them. It's true. You and I are going to have to be willing to hook up with the Holy Ghost and start preaching the gospel the way the Lord demands it.
Amen.
With the Mount of Transfiguration.
Amen.
An unveiling of the supernatural.
Yes.
A removal of the dimension between that which is unseen and seen. Signs and wonders and demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power. That starts with an authority, within a power.
Amen.
With rivers of love and compassion, a deep compassion for people. Thank you, Jesus. If I went behind you and I interviewed people that knew you on a daily basis and I said, on a scale of 1 to 10, how compassionate would you say this person is? And 10 being most compassionate, I hope that every one of you would get a 10. Did they see a tenderness in you? There's a compassion in you. On a scale of 1 to 10, tell me how much they're talking to you about the kingdom. What did they look like? Did you know that they were a Christian? Kind of thing. And I hope every one of you get a 10. Because that's all a part of the rest. Because sometimes we want to have the rest without having the risk. The commitment. Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me, in my words, in this adulterous and sinful generation, in other words, if you value their opinion so much that you're not willing to talk about me, I'm telling you, I'm going to be ashamed of you before my Father and His holy angels. I'm telling you, you don't want to run a risk. And you have to understand, that's not something that's wrong with you. That's something that you have allowed to hinder you. That is a description of a place that God wants to develop you to where that influence no longer has such an impact on you. So it becomes a part of prayer. And here's what I do with it. I don't get all discouraged and overwhelmed with myself, and I don't want you to. I just say, I just take it to the Lord. Father, I'm not ashamed of you. Lord Jesus, I'm not ashamed of you. And I never want to be ashamed of you. And I never want to even possibly look like I'm ashamed of you. Lord, give me the ability, strengthen me, Lord, and show me. Help me to give me the words to say. Give me the things to do. Help me to understand how to do this. And see what happens? Your need becomes the passion for your prayer. Seeing your need becomes the passion of prayer. Because the Lord said, already, this is the leveling field. You can't do anything without me. I want you to know how much you need me. I want you to see how much you need me. Because you look and go, wait a minute, I don't even know where to begin. In fact, I could maybe you're standing here tonight and you think, wow, I could actually apply that verse of Scripture in Mark 8:37 to myself. And that is, if you could, you just say, Lord, forgive me. I don't want that. But then you don't look to your own ability. You begin to cry out to Him. And your whole prayer meeting becomes about, Lord, I need boldness. Lord, I need confidence. Lord, I need to know how to flow in your love. Lord, I want your love and your compassion to flow out of me. Lord, I don't want to be ashamed of you. Lord, I don't want to be ashamed of your word. In other words, I don't want to be intimidated. I don't want to be fearful. I don't want to draw back. I don't want to be silent. I don't want to be ashamed in any way. You begin to have that kind of relationship with Father. I'm telling you, you won't even recognize yourself in a year. Hallelujah. Patakara Mashiach. Thank you, Jesus. Say, thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
I'm yours, Lord.
I'm yours, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Ha ha! Woo! Say that one again. I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Say, Lord Jesus, use me.
Lord Jesus, use me.
Strengthen me.
Strengthen me.
You know, when Jesus sent out the disciples and told them to go raise the dead, heal the sick, they were scared out of their mind. It's like, you're going with us, right? He goes, no, your guy's going out on your own. And they're like, what? You can just see them. They're awkward. They're just like walking down. What are we going to do? I mean, who do we even start with? Right? Hey, there's a town over there. Oh, let's just skip that town. Let's go to the next one. We need to talk about it a little bit more. I'm not ready. Are you looking? Because they're just like us. But then finally it's finally like Andrew says, look, we got to start. Come on, man. Let's just do this. Just come. Let's just do it. There's a guy right over there. Look, he's in bad condition. Maybe we shouldn't start with him. No, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's start with him. And he gets up and their mind is blown. They're like, what? And they sound like Tori. When I came walking in tonight, she's talking about the people that got healed, the things that are going on. They return saying, wow, this is amazing. The devils are subject to us. The devil's got to listen to whatever we say. We're the masters of every demonic thing. I want you to go with that confidence tonight. I mean, just go with that. Because it's just that real. It's just that real. It's just that real. Hallelujah. His word is just that real, just that living, just that powerful. Just as he said it to them. He says it to you. Hallelujah. Except for, you've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. You don't have to wait till Pentecost for Pentecost. Hallelujah. Panga dasa berane. Vito rimana. Thank you, Jesus. Well, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.